Hello there. Welcome to another midweek meditation. I am Reverend Devin, and this is a weekly meditation that I do for my churches in Hyde Park, Bakersfield, and Jeffersonville, Vermont. This is also a meditation that I do for anybody who's joining in over YouTube and is looking to nurture a progressive faith. If you're looking for a second opinion on how we can build up a loving faith within our lives, I hope that you like and subscribe, and please feel free to share these videos with anybody you feel called to. Hello, brothers and sisters. Welcome to my midweek meditation, and thank you for joining me. Today, we're going to be talking about gratitude, which I feel a lot of folks, especially folks in the churches that I serve, feel gets hammered home a little bit too often by the church. And I think that there's merit to that. However, gratitude is an important element of faith. It is an exercise that people of faith do in order to locate where good things in our lives come from. And when we are able to recognize where those good things come from, to appreciate them. By appreciating the good things in our lives, appreciating those things that bring good things into our lives, it helps us better share those good gifts with others. And so today we're going to be talking about Luke chapter 17. We'll be going through verses 11 through 19. And this is the parable of the 10 people with leprosy that Jesus heals and the one that comes back. And I feel that we can learn a little bit about how we live into this exercise of faith, of showing gratitude to those in our lives who bring good things, or those things in our lives that bring good things. So let's go through the reading together. Our reading for today comes from Luke 17, verses 11 through 19. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him, keeping their distance. They called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, Jesus, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well." All right, so I feel this passage says a lot, even though it's pretty short. The first thing it does is it sets the stage. Jesus is on the road between Samaria and Galilee, and so as he is traveling, he's interacting with a lot of people, a lot of whom are Samaritans, which were not seen as proper company in Jesus' day and age. They were a persecuted minority in Jewish society. They were Jewish themselves, but a lot of people didn't consider them to be. And that is because they came from a group of people in Israel who had opened their arms, their homes, to people from different lands. They had intermarried. They had adopted different customs. They brought that into their lives. And a lot of folks who were descended from the upper class in Israel in Jesus' day did not see that as something that was appropriate in proper company. And so what this passage is doing in a lot of ways is showing us that Jesus is walking through a place where there are a lot of folks who are seen as being outsiders. And that's important because when Jesus is approached by these 10 people with leprosy, they are given this gift of healing. But only one of them comes back and recognizes Jesus for the blessing that he had given them. And that is the Samaritan. That is a person that Jesus calls a foreigner, which I think suggests that he had a little bit of bias himself when it came to this person. But the passage is meant to show that often we do not recognize the good that comes to us in our lives, or we take it for granted. And good can come often from the most unexpected of places. Let's talk a little bit about these things that we take for granted, using a large example first. For example, when things are going well in our country, we tend to take for granted things like getting out to vote, things like paying attention to the news. For instance, when we look at the war in Ukraine, there's a lot going on over there. But for a lot of us, because it's been going on for a while, that struggle has, in many ways, faded into the background of our lives. I think that many of us are intentionally trying to remember the people of Ukraine, remember the people of Russia, remember the tragedies that are going on there. For instance, in one of my churches, we have adorned our communion table with the Ukrainian national colors. And sometimes we need to take a step out of our lives, like when we're in church, like by doing something like putting the colors on your communion table. We need to take a little bit of a step out of our lives, a break from our lives, in order to recognize that the experiences of love that God has to give us often go beyond what we see or hear or experience day to day. The criticism that I feel this passage in Luke is bringing to us is that when things are going well for us in our lives, we will often forget everything else. We'll forget the responsibility or the call that God gives to us to try to seek out love in the world. The example of a Samaritan, for instance, is a very powerful social criticism that this passage is bringing forward, because Samaritans were persecuted people in their day and age. And by having a Samaritan come back and recognize that Jesus was the source of his healing, that's the same as us today saying, well, it was an illegal immigrant who came back and recognized that Jesus gave them something special. We often assume that if things are good for us, things must be good for the rest of the world. But Jesus is telling us that's not right. This Samaritan had a lot of struggle outside of just having leprosy. And even though Jesus gave them a gift of healing, Jesus didn't heal everything that this one person who came back and recognized him was dealing with. There was a lot of struggle going on outside of the experiences of these 10 people with leprosy. And I think that that's what this passage is trying to open our minds to. I'll share a quick story to try to ground that. I lived for a number of years in New York City. And the first 2 years that I was there, I was just trying to figure out where to go with my life. And I remember often walking to work early in the morning, dark out, walking the streets, and I never really felt a lot of fear for my own personal safety. I'm a pretty big guy, and as a result, I don't think that a lot of people would want to mess with me, even if I was walking down a sidewalk early morning by myself in the middle of New York City. This story I often compare to a story that my younger sister shared with me once about walking down a city street early in the morning as she was going to work. But the difference for her was a person in a pickup truck pulled up alongside her and started catcalling out the window towards her as she was walking down the street, and he followed along with her until she ducked into an alley in order to just hide from this person. And she waited there for a while as this person circled the block looking for her before driving off. I can only imagine the type of fear that would enter into your heart when you have something happen like that to you. And honestly, that's so far outside of my own lived experience, because let's face it, that's not something that happens to me. And so in hearing this story that my sister shared with me, I had to recognize that is something that happens outside of my lived experience. I'm not going to be able to connect with that. But you know who can? Millions of women. Billions of women throughout this world. I think that we, as people of faith, have a responsibility to try to keep our ears, our minds, our eyes, our hearts open to the experiences of others. Open to the fact that there's a lot of pain in the world that we're not aware of, but also open to the fact that there's a lot of love in the world that we're not aware of. And if we are able to live into that practice of being aware, it allows us to be grateful. It allows us to recognize that good. It allows us to follow in the example of that good. And that is an important way in which we as people of faith are able to grow in our understanding of God, in our understanding of what love should be like within this world. Gratitude is not just about bowing your head down, prostrating yourself like this Samaritan leper did and saying, "You are superior to me." I don't think that that's what gratitude's about. I think gratitude is a way in which we can learn and grow. Gratitude is about recognizing something good that happened to us. And I think that gratitude is only one part of the equation. Gratitude is us recognizing the good that is done for us. I think we also need to recognize that if we're able to recognize the good that is done for us, we can do good for others. And then we become the source of gratitude. It's a chain reaction of love that I think can help heal the world. But you can't pass the baton of God's love if people aren't able to recognize that you have it. If people aren't willing to take it from you, if people are not willing to show gratitude. And so this passage, though short, I do say, Inc., says a lot. And my hope for you all going into this week, or getting through this week, my hope is that you'll find a lot of things in your life that you can be grateful for.